So we're talking about what it costs for a person to play a game. It costs spontaneity. Can't be spontaneous because everything you do has to conform to the assumptions of the game you're playing. Can't be yourself because you're only allowed to be that part of yourself that's contained within the boundaries of the game. So you can't be your whole self. You can only be a tiny fraction of who you really are. It costs you real love and real contact with people, because a person can only get so close to you. That is, they can only get to the exterior of the show part, you know, the part that you show, the exterior part of the mask, and it can't get any closer to you than that part of the game. It can only come up to the outside of the game and can't ever come closer to you than the outside of the game. Because if they did, then they would be able to see that everything that you're showing is actually artificial. It's not authentic. It's a game. And that would destroy the game. You don't get to be creative because you only get to operate within one or two channels of the game strategy. And show those one or two channels or scripts. Be authentic, because the game is a facade, and you can't be responsive to your environment. You have to play according to the rules or the assumptions of the game. There's some of the things that it costs a person when they play a game. They are only aware of the payoff that they receive because the payoff is contained within the assumptions of the game machine. But the true costs of the game are very clear and significant and relevant. However, awareness of them is usually only outside of the assumptions of the game. An example of this in the real world would be nuclear power plants. See, nuclear power plants from within the assumptions, you know, the small view of the game, well, they're very clean, you know, they don't put out a bunch of smoke and soot and that causes acid rain. You know, it's just that little cloud of steam that comes up in the sky, and there's no garbage or sewer or they just make a little heat, you know, they kind of warm up the water a little bit around there, which is, you know, who cares? So the payoff is like you just take some plutonium or uranium refined minerals and you stick them together and they create heat, and the heat makes steam, and the steam drives a turbine, and the turbine makes electricity, and it's like free electricity, basically. Perfectly clean, free electricity. So that's the payoff. Is, you know, the payoff is that you get something for nothing, and that's what it looks like. But the truth is that in the big picture, the nuclear power plants create nuclear waste products, and nuclear waste products are highly toxic and incredibly dangerous to all life on the planet, not just human life, but all life on the planet, because of the radioactive nucleotides. And these radioactive toxic wastes last 50,000 years minimum. So it's impossible to get rid of them. You can't stick them in concrete and put them under the ocean, which is the standard method used now, one of the standard methods, because in far less than 50,000 years, the concrete will be completely disintegrated, and all those wastes are totally exposed to the earth, to the ocean currents, to sea life that carries them this way and that way, and then dies and gets eaten by other sea life that carries them this way and that way and dies. Or another technique is to put them way deep underground in abandoned salt mines and just leave 55-gallon metal cans or filled with nuclear waste products that are highly toxic and radioactive for 50,000 years. And in 50,000 years, you know, water tables change, streams can come through the mines, or earthquakes happen and cracks form and, you know, volcanoes erupt. I mean, you don't know, it's impossible for a human being to work in the time range that that is as big as 50,000 years. You know, that's about as long as human beings as a species have existed on the planet. So, a lot can happen in that time, and the cost is the payoff is that we don't have to be responsible. If we only operate in the small assumption of free power from nuclear power plants, we don't have to be responsible for 50,000 years worth of toxic, you know, lethal, highly poisonous waste products that we're littering the planet with in quite an abundance. But the true cost is we could be, you know, poisoning the entire future generations of humanity and wiping ourselves off the planet. So that's the a comparison between a payoff for a game and the cost of the game. So as we were saying, one way to monkey wrench a game machine is to inject the awareness of the costs of the game, you know, what it's really costing, into the inside of the game machine, and that'll build up too much pressure, and the game can't tolerate that much pressure from inside and would explode and come apart. So for this method of monkey wrenching a game machine to work, the trainer, and for the second major technique that I want to talk about called doorways, a trainer must first make contact and establish relationship, like intimate relationship with a person. Hold on. Scratch the hold on. They must make that kind of, that level of intimate, solid, firm, connected contact in order for the technique to work. So we're assuming that as a trainer that you know what the contact is, what contact means. It's described elsewhere. Exercises are given elsewhere. But in terms of contact with working with game machines, so the actual title of this article is Game Machine Theory. So what you want to do as a trainer is bond with the person who you're working with by agreeing with them. What that means is that when they begin to blame and justify and resent and explain all the details of the only possible solution to life that they've created for themselves, instead of making them wrong or making fun of them or teasing them or blaming them for being stupid or unconscious or whatever, instead of doing that, what you do is you agree with them. you agree 100% with everything that they say. And it's the opposite of what they expect. They expect that they have to defend themselves and protect themselves against your criticisms and judgments and against your intrusiveness. But in fact, what you're doing is you're agreeing with them, and you're establishing bonding and contact with them. And you do this by keeping one foot outside of the game machine and going inside, the other foot inside the game machine, and establishing contact with them. So at first they are not aware of the fact that you have one foot outside of the game machine. They're only aware of you coming in and making contact with them in their world, and which is a new experience for them, in a way that they feel safe, that they really get that you understand their situation and that you're okay with it. You are 100% okay with their only possible solution to life. And you accept them and you approve of them and you're in contact with them and you're bonded with them and you say yes. You know, you are with them and you are saying yes. So then once they are bonded with you and connected with you and trust you, then what you do is you maintain that contact, that intense level of contact, and take what you're doing here is you're working with their attention. So you take their attention and you're putting their attention on you. So their attention is not on defending themselves or on the assumptions of their game strategy, their game machine, or their fear or their anger or any of those things. You're taking their attention, bringing their attention to you. And once their attention is with you, once they are with you and you are with them, then what you do is you keep your attention on them and simultaneously back out of the assumptions of their game machine. You move backwards right through the wall of assumptions of their game machine. And because they are with you, they are with you. And what happens is they suddenly find themselves in a domain outside of their game machine. It's a new environment for them. And they didn't even really know how they got there. They don't actually need to know. All they need to do is recognize then that they are no longer functioning within the constraints of the assumptions of the game machine, and can function differently then. They can be something different than who they are functioning within the constraints of the game machine. So they don't have to do this contact only with you as a trainer. It's quite possible for them to make contact with another person, a man with man, woman with woman. And once they have established contact with another person in an authentic, real way, which means without being protected by their defense strategy, you know, the game machine, then this is an entirely new reference point for them, a new reference point upon which they can base the fabrication of a new game machine, because by backing through the wall with them in contact with you, they've come with you into a new place, and their old game machine doesn't contain the new place. So the old game machine is destroyed, and it's destroyed in a subtle way. And what the subtle way is that by having human contact, intimate human contact with another human being, that experience indicates or points in the direction of what it has cost them previously to not have this experience in their life. So what you're doing is bringing the awareness of the costs into their space by having an experience of human contact, and like that's one of the main costs that playing the game strategy produces or has a side effect of. And since the new experience is okay with them, you know, and they want it, they've been longing for it, they've been starving for that food, once they have that experience and know that it's okay, that the other person is okay with them and they are okay with the other person, then the game, the original game machine has been destroyed, and a new one will form, which contains that experience. It's big enough to hold that experience. So that's how to monkey wrench a game machine, by bringing a larger, by bringing an experience that's more intense or larger than can be contained by the game machine into the game machine, and then allowing that to explode the game machine from the inside out. So the other technique using that begins with contact is similar. It's a similar technique, but instead of actually creating the experience of human contact for a person, what you're doing is working through a different domain of experience, which is more the intellect or the mind. And this technique is called the doorway technique, because what you will do in this technique is you establish contact with a person with one foot outside the game machine, one and your other foot inside the game machine, as described above, and then begin calling forth an image of a different possibility for that person. For example, there was an example of a pastor from a Baptist church who came into an event with the game machine going around and around in a drama where he was the victim, and his 200 200 person congregation were all bringing him their problems and bringing him, you know, fix this, solve this, what do I do? And the people in the town were not serving him, because he's the pastor and deserves to be served in the church. And they weren't agreeing with him or supporting him or serving him, so he was pissed off about that and hated them. And the people in his village were all bringing him their problems, and they wanted him to do things that he couldn't possibly do and solve things he didn't know how to solve. And then it didn't have enough time for his children and his family and his wife, and he was blaming, and he was coming in, came into the event thinking, like, his vision then was his only possible solution to that problem was to quit the whole thing, was to quit being a pastor. Because at one point he had a vision, at one point he had been inspired, but no longer. He was now a total victim to the entire situation. There was nothing he could do about it. He was powerless, and he was thinking of quitting the whole job and abandoning the whole thing and going into the world and starting a video computer electronics store. and starting a new business that way. And that was his only possible solution. So what happened was, is we established contact with him, and he expressed rage at the guy in town that pissed him off, and he because it turned out to be his father, and he went through that rage, and then but then that was early on in Saturday, and it's, by Saturday afternoon he had just put that all back together into his potato act. It was acting like a with a smile on his face, and powerless and weak and soft, and just like a potato, you know, a couch potato. And so by Saturday night, we took him and put him on the floor into a rage hold and really let his body reorder with the maximum expression of rage. And as soon as that had been accomplished, this tremendous well of sadness came out, and he cried on the floor, sobbed for almost a half hour of his deep grief and sadness of not being able to do what all these people wanted him to be able to do. He was, you know, and failing, and their vision of him was not, he couldn't fulfill their expectations, and he couldn't serve them because of the constraints of his game machine. It wouldn't allow him to be anything other than a sniveling potato victim. So what, at that point, we had deep contact with him, and what we did was began to create for him a new vision of what was possible for him as a man. It's and this technique is called the doorway, and it's really similar to what Bugs Bunny does when he's, Bugs Bunny is a cartoon rabbit character who's like a hero, or a, you know, the coyote. He's like a coyote, sly, the archetypal coyote, wise coyote character. You know, that's who he represents. He has and anytime he gets stuck in a impossible situation, he kind of picks up a can of black paint and a paintbrush, and paints a doorway into a rock or into a wall or through the floor or even in in the sky, you know, in the air. He paints this doorway into the air, puts down the paint can, opens the door, walks through the door, closes the door behind him, and goes somewhere that nobody else can go. So he has the possibility of making a doorway out of anything or any situation. He creates a doorway. So this is the technique of the trainer uses to not be confined to the same constraints or restrictions of a person's game machine. And once they're in contact with him, he can paint for them. He can like take their hand, dip it into the paint, and move their hand through the air to paint for them and describe a doorway into an entirely different space or entirely different set of possibilities, an entirely different set of restrictions and constraints that is far, far greater than the game machine that they're stuck in now. And the contrast between the game machine that they're in that disempowers them and restricts them compared to the new doorway that's been painted out of nothing and opened up into that empowers them and gives them power, provides them power and clarity and the ability to be brave and kind and healthy and happy. What happens is that at some point, the person is standing there with, they have 1 foot through the old door and 1 foot through the new door, and then they have a choice. It's like either one is just as valid, either one is just as real, both of them are, you know, really just simply manufactured out of nothing. They're just creations. They are creations. And the first one they created and they have lived in for, 10, 20, 30, 40, 50 years, they've lived in this same, confined little doorway, cramped up space that disempowers them and creates drama for them and uses up their energy. And or this new doorway that leads into an untold things, a completely different universe. They have a choice. And both of them are equally valid. And it's totally up to them whether they go back into the door, the game machine that they're originally in, or they abandon the old game machine for no reason, really, without reason, and just simply step through the new door into an entirely new game machine, not even knowing how it functions or the limits of it, or just knowing that it empowers them. They can, and they get that by the sense of it, the feel of it. So, we painted this picture for the pastor. We gave him the key for this new door was what it means to bless somebody, and the image of himself as being a king of a kingdom of 200 people, and that the truth being, or the image being, that all of the problems and all of the troubles and all of the work that his congregation brings to him is that it's not for him, that that he can receive all of that from all of those people, and all he has to do is pass it on up the line. He can pass these problems and these pains and this trouble up to who he's serving. He can pass it to his boss, and his job is simply to be a representative for his boss and receive and make contact with people. So his job becomes not one of solving problems, not one of consoling or fixing things or making things better or the peacemaker or any of those things. His job is simply to be in contact with a person, to greet them and bless them. And the technique for greeting somebody and blessing them is just to make contact with them and say hello. And that's why he has a 200-person congregation, is that people know he has the capacity to bless, to just look at people and say hello. And by that kind of contact, that he can receive all of a person's pain and all of a person's problems and pass it on up the line, it doesn't even touch him. He's just a conductor for that. And it goes right through him without any effort at all, no residue, no problem for him, absolutely no cost to him, and his job becomes one of being a king, and the king's job is to bless the people, and this new image of his job, this new vision for him of who he was with regards to his life situation, was a new doorway for him. And we painted that doorway, and without hesitation, he decided and went through the new doorway. Completely abandoning the previous strategy, the previous game machine. So the important thing about using the doorway technique is to only create a door or open a door to possibility that is possible for a person to sustain once they have left the event. That is, that what the doorway is, what the possibility is, has to be really essentially something that the person has created for themselves. It has to be something that they're prepared for or able to hold together or to keep together or to sustain. Because if you open a doorway to a possibility that is too great for a person, then even though they might go through the doorway and agree with it or appreciate it, in the confines of the event during the weekend, when they go back into their life, the level of practice with which they engage their life is not sufficient enough to sustain the new vision that's through the new doorway. So it's not stable, and then it disassembles. So out in the world, and then the way it disassembles in the world is that once in the world, there's such a contrast between the new vision and their life that they have to either destroy their life or destroy the new vision. And most people in that situation do not have enough of a support system to allow their life to disassemble, and instead they allow the new vision that was through the new doorway to disassemble, which means they have to discount the event. They discount the entire experience of the weekend and destroy that in their life, rather than destroying all the dramas of their life and being able to let that go. So it's a danger that a trainer must be aware of too. When they're in contact with a person, you know the size of their being. You can get a sense of who they are as a person. You can feel how big their essence is. And if their essence is not big enough to sustain the practice necessary to keep them in the, to function in the context of their new vision and their new, through the new door, then it won't be stable and it won't survive. So you want to create a possibility for people that works for them and that will work in their life. So it's a you don't want to make the doorway too small or too big. It has to really fit who a person is in their life. So the there are really three techniques that were described here. One's called monkey wrenching, this last one is called the doorway technique, and then the middle one that we were calling is really called exploding. And you exploding is the one where you bring in an external awareness of the costs of a game, and which are too big for the game machine to contain, and it explodes the machine. So the the truth is that all three techniques require contact. The trainer must be in contact, because, and please insert this into the, before all three techniques, that all three techniques require contact between a trainer and the person. And here's a description of how the trainer must be in contact with a person before he monkey wrenches, before he uses the monkey wrench technique to disassemble a game machine, is that the monkey wrench has to know where to place the monkey wrench. He has to know how big the monkey wrench has to be. He has to know the timing that the timing of how to slip the monkey wrench in so it's really in and produces like a chain reaction of destruction that takes the whole machine apart in the most efficient way. So if you try to monkey wrench a game machine without being in contact with the person, then they take it as an attack, and the machine's complete defenses come up, and it's impossible for the monkey wrenching to be successful, because it doesn't come from love. It's not perceived as coming from love. It's perceived as coming from hate, as an attack. And therefore, instead of allowing the monkey wrenching to occur, a person defends against it, and the monkey wrenching is not a win for them.